Can you hear me?
Good morning. Welcome to the Newman Center on this 26th Sunday in Ordinary Time. Please stand, greet those around you, and join in our opening song.
Tony. Again.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Today is a very important Sunday for us because this Wednesday, October 4th, the Feast of St. Francis, our church will be gathering together the 16th General Assembly of the synodal nature of our church. Some 300 bishops and women and men and women and the Pope will gather to again promote our synodalism. in our church. Synodalism is that we listen more than we talk. I'm talking too much now, maybe. But it means not listening with the ears. Throw them away. You don't need them. Listening with the heart. And what we want to hear is the conscience of every person, because God is present in each and every one of us. And in the sacrament of baptism, the little child that you baptized yesterday has the same Holy Spirit as I or you have in yourself or anybody else. So it's something that we have kind of forgotten about in our church. I might be the only Catholic in the Diocese of St. Cloud that remembers 1950, when I was 16 years old, our pastor in Royalton, Minnesota, Father Ted Roble, got up in the pulpit. He got a letter from Bishop Bush, and he's supposed to ask us if we believe that the Blessed Virgin Mary went body and soul into heaven. And we couldn't vote on it. And he was kind of sheepish. He didn't know what to do, but he says, I know you all believe that. If she didn't make it, who will? And then he reported, he said, I'll just tell the bishop that we all believe that she is in heaven. Before that, you didn't have to believe that. Now, good Catholics, you have to believe that the Blessed Virgin is in heaven. So, that's how our church works. It's supposed to work. That everybody expresses what the Holy Spirit is saying in them. That means we have to listen to the young people. We have to listen to the poor people, no matter what color, no matter what party they belong to. To bring people together in communion. We're all united. Everything is more important than whatever party or sex or whatever else you have. Today, let's be sorry for all our sins, especially anything we did to separate us. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done, and what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask the Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let's give glory to God.
Bless you.
Let us pray. O God, who manifest your almighty power above all by pardoning and showing mercy, bestow, we pray, your grace abundantly upon us, and make those hastening to attain your promise heirs to the treasures of heaven. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and rules with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Let's listen to the word of God.
A reading from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. Thus says the Lord, you say the Lord's way is not fair. Hear now, house of Israel, is it my way that is unfair? Or rather, are not your ways unfair? When someone virtuous turns away from virtue to commit inequity and dies, it is because of the inequity he committed that he must die. But if he turns from the wickedness he has committed and does what is right and just, he shall preserve his life. Since he has turned away from all the sins that he has committed, he shall surely live. He shall not die. The word of the Lord.
Be to God.
Oh,
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Brothers and sisters, if there is any encouragement in Christ, any solace in love, any participation in the Spirit, any compassion and mercy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, with the same love, united in heart, thinking one thing. Do nothing out of selfishness or out of vainglory. Rather, humbly regard others as more important than yourselves, each looking out not for his own interests, but also for those of others. Have you in the same attitude that is also in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be grasped. Rather, he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, coming in human likeness and found human in appearance. He humbled himself, became obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, that of the name of Jesus. Every knee should bend of those in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Is it better if I use this one or that one? Is it okay? Thank you. Jesus said to the chief priests and elders of the people, "What is your opinion? A man had two sons. He came to the first and said, 'Son, go out and work in the vineyard today.' He said in reply, 'I will not,' but afterwards changed his mind and went. The man came to the other son and gave the same order. He said in reply, 'Yes, sir,' but did not go. Which of the two did his father's will?" They answered, "The first." Jesus said to them, "Amen, I say to you, tax collectors and prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God before you. When John came to you in the way of righteousness, You did not believe him, but tax collectors and prostitutes did. Yet even when you saw that, you did not later change your minds and believe him. The Gospel of the Lord. Maybe these two boys could have been like 18 years old or 20 or 25. I don't know. I'm guessing that the father and the mother knew their boys pretty well. They sort of knew them inside and outside. And they probably knew their stories and what they're going to do and what they're going to say. So as I'm thinking of that, I'm thinking also about this great thing that's happening in our church today, that we want to get back to our synodalism. We are synodal Catholics. That's the way Jesus started it. And it pretty well just means that the same Holy Spirit that's in you is in me and everybody else, no matter who that person might be. I should start out by saying, I am a lonely person. Oh, I have lots of friends that talk to me about the weather, but at 89 years old, I've heard that so many times, it's getting kind of boring. Or they might talk to me about the high price of living. That's getting kind of boring too. But if someone listens to me, and then someone breaks into it, cuts it off, and in other words, shuts me up, I feel frustrated. That's where my loneliness is. They say that we live in a lonely age. I know that when people listen to me, I feel good. I like it. Someone appreciates me. And that's what synodalism is all about. Listening to another person. It's very valuable because, number one, you don't have to correct a person, no matter what they say. You don't have to judge them, saying you're no good, wrong, bad. You don't have to tell them you got to be a Catholic. There's other stuff too. But what it does say is that when the person feels good, and they feel good because you listen to them without realizing it, you might be attracting them to something better. That's up to them. The example I like to use, I may have told you this before, I think I was here this spring, can't remember. I went fishing on Mayo Lake. I was standing on a dock. There was a young man there, about 22. He was fishing. Well, we started talking about fishing, about fishing, about fishing, about fishing, about fishing, about fishing. Well, you know, when you're 89, you talk about fishing, about fishing, about fishing, about fishing. It gets kind of boring. I remembered I am a synodal Catholic. So I told him, I am a Catholic. We Catholics aren't doing very well nowadays. We're all sinners. More people are leaving the church than joining the church. Our churches are empty. Since we're synodal Catholics, we should go and ask others, how could we be better? We claim we are want to know Jesus. We want to follow him. We want to be his disciples. We want to build his kingdom. Everybody wants his kingdom. His kingdom is where everybody is happy and helps other people and loves each other and listens to everybody. So I was wondering if maybe I could ask you for your advice. How could we, if it's okay with you, how could we Catholics be better, follow Jesus better? Well, he said, I don't know. I don't belong to any religion. I'd like to belong to a church, but there's so many out there, I wouldn't have a clue which one to look into. I thought about that. I said to myself, the next day, of course, or that afternoon, I wouldn't know what church to join either. There are so many people looking for the gospel, the good news that we are liberating from. Last Thursday, for the second time, I met a woman who lives in one of the apartments, and she says to me, I remember you. She says, a month ago, we were talking. And she said, by the way, this is a non-stop talking woman. And she says, you never answered my questions. Oh, I said, really? Yeah, I said, now I remember. And so she said, yeah, I asked you lots of questions. And we had a nice conversation, she says, and I really enjoyed it. And I went home and I told everybody about it, but then I couldn't remember. Well, you never answered my questions. It's true, I didn't answer her questions. Like I said, she was a nonstop talker. If I had answered her questions, it would take me about this much time to do it. And she would have been already talking other stuff. I would say I did the better thing. Sometimes you just don't answer the questions if it's with a nonstop talker. Each case is different. I think I've purposely listened intentionally maybe to over 100 people now. And it's so interesting what people are thinking, believing. And it always reminds me, as you read the scriptures, it tells you that God is speaking to each individual. I like to call it the conscience. God is present in each individual, and let them decide what they're going to do with what they hear. They will make that decision. We should not try to make that decision for them. That's what our synodalism is all about. We don't go telling people to belong to our church. We don't go judging them. I personally am prejudiced. I grew up in a prejudiced culture. And I feel superior to some other people. I'll tell you, black people here, you African Americans, Indians, I feel superior to you. But now I recognize that it's wrong of me. I have to overcome that. I have to ask the Lord. You don't have to tell me that. I know that. I have to ask the Lord, help me to overcome my sin. That's wrong. That's sinful. Because we're all siblings in God's family, no matter what color we might be. There are so many things we as Catholics got to learn, and we can learn it from others because God is speaking not only in me, not only in that baby over here, not only in that mother over there, speaking in all of us. And we're being catechized with catechism whenever we have an encounter like that. Be good listeners. I believe
the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, all things are born in him.
I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God of God, light from God, true God, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. Our Lord and Spirit was incarnate and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, according with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead. And his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and life of the world to come. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus, we ask you now to listen to our petitions.
For the church, on the eve of a new phase of the synodal journey, that the presence of the gospel, alive and at work in her, may make her like the vineyard in the parable, a vital place where all men and women who seek meaning in their life find a place, a word, a breath of hope. We pray.
Lord,
hear our prayer. For the bishops and all the participants in this synodal assembly, that proposals may spring forth from their listening to the Holy Spirit, so that the entire people of God, in a dynamism of community, may feel that they are truly participating in the life of the church and be a living and attractive witness to the newness of the gospel in the world. We pray. For theologians, may the gifts of wisdom and revelation accompany their contribution to the work of the Synodal Assembly, so that the gift of faith may become life in all God's people. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For young people, seekers of truth and authentic witness, concreteness and spirituality, that as a result of the synodal journey, they may feel increasingly involved in the church's life and mission in the midst of the challenges of today's world, giving to so many with the enthusiasm of their age the hope that springs from an encounter with Jesus. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For us gathered here in communion with Christian communities throughout the world, that by tasting the goodness of the Lord that comes to each one of us in the body and blood of Jesus, we may receive from him a fresh view of our neighbor and be made witnesses to generosity in the world in which we live. We pray. For those who have died, as well as for the members of the Colzer family for whom this Mass is being offered, may they rejoice in the fullness of your everlasting life. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the prayers in our parish book of prayers and for those that we hold in the silence of our hearts, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Yes, Lord, we thank you. We have come to trust in you, and we know that you lead us into your kingdom forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands. It will become for us the bread of life. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine, work of human hands. It will become for us the our spiritual drink. Pray, sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be pleasing to God, the Almighty Father. Amen. Amen. Grant us, O merciful God, that this our offering may find acceptance with you, and that through it the wellspring of all blessing may be laid open before us through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For we know it belongs to your boundless glory that you came to the aid of mortal beings with your divinity, and even fashioned for us a remedy out of mortality itself, that the cause of our downfall might become the means of our salvation through Christ our Lord. Through him, the host of angels adores your majesty and rejoices in your presence forever. May our voices, we pray, join with theirs in one chorus of exultant praise as we acclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, and Patrick our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
And let us offer one another a sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring eternal life to us who receive it. Amen. Come to the table of the Lord. Jesus wants to feed us. The journey is long.
Front on the left.
The body of Christ. The body of Christ.
Amen.
El cuerpo de Cristo, the body of Christ.
Yeah.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray. May this heavenly mystery, O Lord, restore us in mind and body, that we may be co-heirs in glory with Christ to those to whose suffering we are united, whenever we proclaim his death, who lives and rules forever and ever.
Amen.
So there's a special blessing today.
First, we've got a few announcements. The first is that next Sunday is our feast day of St. John Henry Newman, so please join us for liturgy here at 10 a.m., and then we'll have a special coffee and rolls celebration afterwards. So please plan to join us next Sunday after Mass down in the terrace. Finally, this Thursday is our Oktoberfest event. It's going to be really fun. We've got beanbag tournament, brats, and some beverages. So please join us, both permanent members and students, this Thursday at 6 o'clock p.m. down in the terrace. And finally, our community meal for October will be on the 14th. Please consider helping either bring a food item for that or to help serve that meal on the 14th. Thank you.
So this special blessing that our Pope wants to have as we begin our synodal year again with the 300 bishops and women and men that are getting united in Rome, I wish that you would receive this blessing not only for yourselves but for all the people in the world. Brethren and sisters, Jesus promised to be present in the midst of his disciples gathered in his name. In the coming days at Rome, Pope Francis will open the first session of the 16th Ordinary General Assembly of the Synod of Bishops. Invoking the blessing of the Lord, we lift our minds to God, that by the sharing of the Holy Spirit, he may strengthen our communion, lead us to all truth, and enlighten the participants of the Synodal Assembly without ceasing. May our God and Father, who in many and various ways spoke to our fathers through the prophets, direct you and the whole church in fidelity to his word and in discernment of his will. May the only begotten Son, sent in the fullness of time to manifest to all the riches of the Father's mercy, keep you in communion with himself and your brothers and sisters.
Amen.
May the Holy Spirit lead you all, and especially the Synodal Assembly, to perceive the signs of the times, so that adhering to the will of God in all things, you may bear the abundant fruit of unity, by promoting the life of the church and witnessing to the gospel.
Amen.
And thank you. And may Almighty God bless you. Name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace, serve the Lord, and tell others all you know about Jesus.
Time. his name.